Welcome to this Slumberland sleep story. I would like to take this moment to wish you the most peaceful night's sleep and pleasant dreams as you fall asleep to this bedtime story. And before we begin the story, you can take a few moments to settle down comfortably. You can shift about a little if you need to make yourself even more comfortable. And when you're ready, you can let your eyes gently close. And as the story unfolds, you can take a few deep, relaxing breaths, allowing the out-breaths to be a little longer than the in-breaths. This triggers the body's natural relaxation response. And this is a sleep story about a woman who is walking through some sand dunes along the edge of the coast. And among the sand dunes there are dry, coarse grasses. And as she walks along, so she can see the way the dry sand is catching the breeze, creating occasional dust clouds of sand. And she continues to walk through these dunes, with that distant sound of the sea alongside her, the blue sky overhead. And as she walks along, so she can hear the singing of a robin and sees a robin land on a fence which runs around the outside of the sand dunes, fencing off some sand dunes which are currently being protected and given the opportunity to grow and rewild. And she stops for a while as she approaches that robin to listen and watch the robin singing on that post, its mouth moving with its song, its throat moving as it sings. And after a little while of singing, that robin flies on to the next post, continues singing on that post. Its beautiful red breast, catching the sunlight, seeming to almost glow in the sun. She continues to walk through these dunes. As she walks through the dunes, so she sees a small hut. Then she approaches that hut, and she can see a small chair outside the hut, and a man sat in that chair. And as she walks past, she smiles and greets the man in a friendly manner. And the man just seems to glare at her. And she thinks to herself how grumpy this man seems. And walking past a little way, she stops. She looks out to sea. She sits down on the dunes, gazing out to sea, just a little way down from that hut. And occasionally she turns to face the man in that hut, saying things like, "It's beautiful weather today. Doesn't the sea look nice? The way the sun's glistening on the surface as the waves gently roll towards the shore." The man just seems to grunt and not seem to want to engage in conversation. And after a little while, she stands up and goes to walk away. And the man calls to her and says, "I've got something that you can have. Perhaps you'll find it interesting. You seem like you're an inquisitive person." He reaches down beside him, fiddles around in what looks like a toolbox of knick-knacks next to him, and pulls out an old pocket watch, and then reaches over in the woman's direction, and she heads over to the man, takes the watch, pops the cover open on that pocket watch, sees that it's currently not running, but those hands are just stuck in time. The man says, "Find somewhere to sit, somewhere you won't be disturbed, somewhere that you can pay that pocket watch all of your attention, and then explore that watch. And I think you'll be pleasantly surprised." And the woman thanks the man, closes the watch front, and sets off, continuing on her journey. And that man continues to just gaze out to sea from his hut. And after some time of walking, the woman arrives at a river, heading inland from the beach. She walks down the side of that river, following the riverbank, watching the way the reeds in the river sway and move as the waves lap onto the shore, while that water pushes down the river. And this is a tidal river. And she walks along, following that riverbank, to a stone bridge. And as she walks away from the coast, so she leaves the sound of the sea behind her. Just hear the gentle lapping of the river. She arrives at that stone bridge, crosses the bridge, continues her journey, following a road the other side of the bridge. Heading along through meadows with hedgerows either side of the road, walking along with almost an amble to be able to relax and enjoy the environment while walking, the warmth of the sun overhead, watching the shadows pass across the land as clouds travel through the sky. Before heading into some woodland, walking through that woodland, out the other side of the woodland, into a meadow that's just open and sprawling, standing for a moment to take in the view, to breathe in the fresh air, seeing the sheep on hills in the distance, a field of cows, a couple of horses in another distant field, grazing and relaxing. The rabbits in the meadow, bees and butterflies travelling from plant to plant. She continues to walk, and after some time of walking, she decides that this location is a quiet location to take that pocket watch and have a good look at it. She sits up on a hillside in this meadow. She looks around her. She can feel the warmth of the sun on her face, the occasional tickle of cool breeze on her cheeks. And she takes that watch out of her pocket, pops the front open, listens closely to the watch. And just hears silence. And then decides to wind that watch up to see if it starts, or perhaps if it's broken. So she winds the watch up. She sets the time to the current time. She can hear the mechanism working inside the watch. And the watch begins to tick. And as that watch ticks, she can see that at the top of the watch face looks like a small window, and in that small window are phases of the moon and the sun, and it seems to move across that window, perhaps showing what the moon is like at that point in time. And so she works at trying to set that. She tries to remember what the moon looked like last night. And tries to set that watch so that the moon as it looked last night is over to the right hand side, with the sun being in the middle now. And the moon, as she imagines it'll be tonight, being on the left-hand side of the sun. And she imagines that if she gets this right, and keeps it wound up, then that sun should circle around and move. And at night time, it should be the moon rising across that window and setting across that window as she will see it, before the sun rising across the window and setting across the window tomorrow. And she sees that there's a date, just a simple number, two-digit number, no monthly number. And so she sets that date to today's date. And she examines that watch to try and see if there's any clues as to how old this watch is. While she's looking around this watch, examining its bottom, its sides, its top, its back, its front, she finds that on the inside of the lid of that front cover of the watch is a small little button, and at first she thinks that maybe the button is perhaps something to do with the spring that makes it so that when you push the button that opens the cover, it pings that cover open, because the button is off to the left side and would probably be pressed when the watch is closed. But then she realizes that if you press that button in, it seems to slide up and down. When the button's out, it doesn't slide up and down. She presses that button in and slides it up and moves her finger, and it pops back out again. It looks about the same as it did before, except now the button is slightly higher. And she still can't figure out what the button is for. And she closes that watch face to see what the working watch looks like through that watch face. And the watch face has an ornate pattern on it, with some gaps at the top that reveal the sun and moon passing across the sky in that window, and some gaps that allow you to just see enough of the hands of the watch to be able to see what time it is, even with the cover closed. And as she closes the cover and it clicks into place, the strangest thing happens, that out of the top of the watch a blue beam appears just a little way forward in front of her. And the blue beam opens up quickly to a wide beam and then begins to rotate, spinning faster and faster. And as it spins faster and faster, so it begins to whir. And while it begins to whir, she realizes that it seems to be somehow changing the view in front of her. And within a few seconds, she notices that that blue light has spread to the outside of the spinning. And in the center, she can see through to some different land, to a different location. It's almost as if this watch has opened up a portal in front of her. And as she's looking at this, her hand is moving around slightly, just from natural moving while holding the watch. And as her hand is moving around naturally, that portal seems stable, as if once it started forming, it took on a life of its own, and it's still connected, almost like by a light thread, to the watch. But it's in front of her in a stable location, a little bit like the way that once a gyroscope is spinning, it can maintain its position even if what it's on changes position. It can maintain that orientation. And holding the watch, she decides to step through that portal. And so she steps through the portal. And in an instant, she finds herself teleported to another land. She realizes that she's walking through a very hot environment. Almost like she's walking through an African savanna. Only she knows that this isn't Earth. She can tell by the fact that when she looks up towards the sky, filling almost half the sky, is what looks like a planet, a bit like Jupiter. Looks like a gas giant hovering in the sky. She can also see what looks like other moons in the sky. Only she assumes that they're probably moons circling that gas giant. And she has this sense like she's probably on a moon circling this gas giant rather than on a planet. And one of the first things she notices, other than that giant planet hovering in the air, is that there's a certain glow to the sky. And she's looking through this glow when she's looking up towards that gas giant. And that is distorting the image, tinging the image with some colour. And she realises there seems to be a very vivid and vast and powerful aurora here. And she knows that on Earth, auroras are mainly just confined to the poles and rarely seen that far towards the equator. And she knows that on Earth the poles are cool, and she assumes that here maybe it's similar. That maybe here the poles would be cool, and yet she's in a warm location and can see this vivid aurora. And she knows on Earth the only times you see an aurora closer to the equator is when more charged particles are striking the Earth and affecting and interacting with the Earth's magnetic field. And she wonders whether this gas giant has a really powerful magnetic field. Maybe particles from the gas giant travel from the gas giant along its magnetic field and are striking the magnetic field of this moon and creating this vivid aurora. And she begins to explore this strange new world. And as she walks, she finds there's a bit more of a bounce or a spring to her step. That the gravity is definitely lower here than on Earth. She can see that the grasses here are taller than on Earth. And as she approaches the trees as she would see them, that are dotted through this warm savanna-like land, that they're thinner and taller too. And then she notices some grazing animals. They have a certain familiarity to them. But at the same time, she's aware that they, too, seem to be a bit taller and skinnier. And there seems to be a general trend here, that beyond a certain size, things seem to grow taller and skinnier. And she watches with intrigue, and then sees what looks like a giant lizard flying in the sky, something she could only describe as being like a dragon, with its enormous wingspan. It seems to just do the occasional flap of its wings, most of its time just gliding, almost silently overhead. She realizes that butterflies here, or animals which look like butterflies, are much larger. As she sees a butterfly with wings like two of her hands flying towards a large plant on the ground. And she explores this land with intrigue. And she can't yet see the sun. She looks around the sky. And it seems that somehow most of the illumination here seems to happen because of the planet and the charged particles, making the sky almost glow. And she looks around and then notices that there is a sun in the sky, but it looks just like a very large star. That it definitely doesn't look like the sun she's used to seeing on Earth. But it also looks incredibly bright for its size. And as the planet that she's on continues to move, the way it's moving, she can tell, reveals that it is just a moon circling that giant gas planet. She can see the way the gas planet itself has a lot of activity and is moving. And as the moon that she's on moves around that gas planet, so one of the other moons that she can see, which is also orbiting the same planet, begins to partially eclipse that star in the sky. And as it does, as the light dims from the star, she sees this enormous spread of a mass ejection from that star, arching in a very steep arch from that star, as if it's heading in her direction. And she wonders about this moon, about this planet. Whether the magnetic field of this giant planet is strong enough to deflect the charged particles from that star, protecting its moons as well as the planet itself. And it seems, from the auroras on this moon, like the moon itself must have a molten core generating a powerful magnetic field here. And she wonders whether this moon has maintained a molten core because of tidal forces with this giant planet, perhaps also with the other moons around this planet. And she explores this planet for a while. And as she explores, so she finds that wherever she goes, that watch seems to maintain a thread to that portal. And she doesn't know whether there's a way of closing the portal and reopening it, and whether if she did that, it would reopen in the same location and get her home. She looks forward to trying to find out, but she wants to try and find out safely. And she explores this area. And after exploring for a while, she heads back to that portal. Walks through the portal. And she doesn't know, as she walks back to that meadow, where that gas giant was in space. Nothing in the sky looked familiar. She then tried that watch, flicking that switch, pushing it in, flicking it downwards. And then closing that watch face again. And just like before, a portal opened up in front of her. And this time, it was to a new location. She walked through the portal and found herself in a crystal cave. She walked through that crystal cave and out the other side of the crystal cave, she thought she saw the most magnificent landscape with mountains, meadows, the most incredible night sky. And just like before, what she saw when she looked up revealed that she wasn't on Earth. She could see from looking up that none of the constellations were recognizable, meaning that it can't be an Earth night sky. But it definitely seemed just like a relatively normal night sky. She walked around in the meadow here. And the only illumination came from a moon in the sky that was obviously reflecting the light of the sun for this location. And she looked around for a while and explored and could feel the coolness of the air here on her cheeks. and she couldn't see much to give away where here was or when here was. And she knew that she agreed with what that old man had said, that she'd find this interesting. And so she headed back through the portal, deciding that it's currently night time there, so she'll go and give it some time before exploring again and see what she can discover in the daytime. But she thought he was right. She will find this pocket watch interesting, and she looks forward to exploring with it further. And that night, she heads home. She settles down in her bed and finds herself drifting and floating so peacefully and so comfortably, relaxed, asleep all night long.